Well, I used to say, and I'm still inclined to say occasionally, that I hate it, that I hate the game of life. I don't really, at least I don't anymore. The reason why I felt like that was that whenever, you know, my name was mentioned in respect of some mathematics, it was always the game of life. And I don't think the game of life was very, very interesting. Don't think it was worth all that. I've done lots of other mathematical things. And so I found the game of life was sort of overshadowing much more important things, and I did not like it. Now, well, I'm getting old. My capacity for hatred is getting less, I suppose. And it was an achievement, and I'm quite proud of it. I just don't want to talk about it all the time.
I'm sorry.
That's all right.
I couldn't not ask you about it.
No, that's okay.
What is the game of life, this thing that is you're stuck with now?
Well, will you be able to focus on this?
Yes, I can focus on that, no problems.
Have I got some coins in my pocket? Curses, I don't have you. In the game of life, you sort of drop a handful of nuts or counters or something. The rules are, at any given time, you've got some of these things that are full, I'll call that live, and some of them that are empty, and we'll call that dead. If you've got too many neighbours, oh yes, the neighbours of a cell are all the eight things nearest to it. If you've got too many neighbours, you die. If you've got four or more, in other words, that's the exact definition of too many, you die of overcrowding, probably because there isn't enough food in that region. But if you've only got one or no live neighbours, you die of isolation. Now, let's look. This guy is going to die of isolation. And this guy only has one neighbour too. They're both going to die. But the other thing is, if you're dead at the moment, but you've got exactly three live neighbours, you see, this guy has one, two, three live neighbours out of the eight places next to him. And so does this guy. Can you see he's got one, two, three? So there's going to be a happy event next time. Two things are going to be born here and here, and these two are going to die. I might as well eat him. This guy's going to die. And these things now, who are babies at the moment, are going to grow up. They're adolescents now. That's rather slow. Next time, I'll just do it quickly. There's going to be somebody born here because he has three live neighbours, and somebody born here. The condition for giving birth is that you have exactly three parents. That seems rather unusual, but it's not really imitating human life, so to speak. It definitely isn't. So the places that I'm pointing to now are going to be born, and this one has four live neighbours. One, two, three, four. So he's going to die, and this one only has one live neighbour, so he's going to die. This guy dies of overcrowding, and this guy right next door dies of isolation. So they're going to die, and the places where my fingers are pointing are going to be born. With this configuration, this is the same shape as it was when I started two moves ago, but it's moved a little bit. And if you just follow it, it'll keep on moving like this forevermore. It's what we call the glider. I wish I hadn't called it the glider, because if you look at it when somebody has programmed a machine for you, it looks more like an ant. I wish I'd called it an ant. It just walks across the plane.
What has been proven about Game of Life then? Since
it's a long time ago. We proved everything about it. Namely, we proved that it could do arbitrary computations, it could build copies of itself, which had interesting properties, could move across the plane. It's hard to say exactly, easily to an audience that doesn't actually understand these things, exactly how we proved those. I'm not entirely responsible for that. When I first told it to Martin Gardner, who wrote the mathematical games column in Scientific American, I advertised, really. I didn't know that it would have these properties. I hoped it would. And so I advertised for a finite configuration which grew indefinitely. That was the simplest testable instance of this sort of ubiquity, this universality. And somebody at MIT, Bill Gosper, and a few colleagues of his, came up with this thing called the glider gun, which emitted a glider every 30 moves. And we played with that and in the end succeeded in proving this universality thing. You know, we called it the game of life because it seemed in a little bit, well, some of the ideas we had were taken from real life. You know, if you have too many organisms of your type in a given region, you die off because there isn't enough food for you or something. If you've too few, well, you know, it's nice to have a few companions. And if you don't have companions, you might as well die. I mean, that's it. And so on. So the basic rules are a tremendous simplification of the rules of sort of real life for very, very simple organisms. You have the unpredictability of real life too. And yet it all comes from very, very simple rules. So I think that's why people are interested. You know, who would have thought, well, I thought, but typically one doesn't think that one can get a decent simulation of real living things in such a very simple way. Mathematician and be good at various things and so on. And in my late 20s, I hadn't achieved any of the things that people were predicting. And so I call it my black period. I started to wonder, you know, whether it was all nonsense, whether I was not a good mathematician after all, and so on.